So let's consider some classical combinatorial optimization problems to have a more concrete idea of what they are. One famous problem is called the knapsack problem. And the knapsack problem can be described in the following way. So let's assume that Patricia is preparing a hike in the mountain and she's carrying a knapsack. And the knapsack has a given capacity, let's say W kilos. This is the maximum that the knapsack can actually hold. And now she considers carrying with her a list of many items, too many actually. There are too many to fit in the sack. N is the number of potential items. Each item has some utility. Some things are more useful than others. And this can be quantified using a quantity UI. So UI is the utility associated with item I. Each item has also a weight. We denote it by WI. So the problem is the following. What is the list of items that Patricia can carry with her in order to maximize the total utility while being able to carry everything in the sack? Let's try to write it as a mathematical model. When you do optimization, there is a first stage which is called modeling. Modeling is transforming your optimization problem into a mathematical formulation. And it involves three steps: defining the decision variables, defining the objective function, and defining the constraints. Actually, this is what we have done in the introduction. In the introduction, in the context of the general framework for simulation, the decision variables were the control variables U. The objective function is the combination of all the indicators generated by the simulator. And the constraints were this combinatorial set, capital U, that we have introduced. In the context of the knapsack, the decision variables are called binary variables because they capture a decision. Variable xi will take the value 1 if item I will be put in the knapsack, and 0 otherwise. So this is why they are called binary. They can take only two values, 1 or 0. What is the objective function? Well, we would like to maximize the total utility of the as item. So here we have a maximization problem. And what is the total utility? Well, we multiply for each item the utility of the item times the variable xi. So it means that if item I is not included in the knapsack, the contribution of this item to the objective function will be 0. And if it is, the contribution of this item to the objective function will be its utility ui. And we do the same for the weight. So this is the total weight of the knapsack. Again, in this sum, if an item I is included in the knapsack, it will contribute to the sum by wi, the weight. And if the item is not included in the knapsack, the contribution to the sum will be 0. So this sum is really the total weight of the sack. And the constraints say that this cannot exceed capital W, which is the capacity of the sack. And finally, we need to be consistent with our definition of the binary variable. So we need to tell the optimization problem that the variables xi can take only two values, 0 and 1. So as I said before, the first idea that comes to mind would be to do an enumeration of the finite set that defines the constraints. So this is usually referred to as a brute force algorithm. Let's consider it in the context of the knapsack problem. If we consider all the objects, each of them can be either in the sack or out of the sack. Okay, so two values for the variable associated with each object. So the total number of possible combinations that we have to consider is 2 to the n, n being the number of items. So the brute force algorithm would consist in the following thing. We should enumerate these 2 to the n combinations. For each of them, we must, one, check that the weight of the combination is feasible. If not, we just ignore it. And if it is feasible, we calculate the utility and check if it is the largest that has been generated so far. And so we remember the largest one, and when we have finished our enumeration, we know which one is the best. So let's look at the computational time of such a brute force algorithm. And let's make the following assumptions to simplify the calculation. So the calculation of the weight is about n floating point, right? We need to calculate for each item the product between the utility and the variable x. And same for the utility. So basically, for each of the combination, there is about 2n floating point operations, which are the number of multiplications that must be done. Now let's assume that we have a 1 teraflops processor. It means that this processor is capable of performing 10 to the 12 floating point operations per second. So let's do some calculation here. If the number of items is 34, this would take about 1 second to solve. So it's pretty efficient and very useful. But now let's increase the value of n. So if we move to n equals 40, it will take about 1 minute. If we add 5 more items, then it will take 1 hour. It's still okay. But if we continue to increase the size, n equals 50, it's about a day. N equals 58, it's about a year. N equals 69, then we are reaching 2,583 years. So this quantity here is basically the length of the Christian era. And we have only 69 items. Now let's go on. If we consider 78 items, we are talking about 1,500,000 years, which is basically the time that elapsed since Homo erectus appeared on Earth. And my final example is when n equals 91, it's about 10 to the 10 years that will be needed to solve the problem using the brute force algorithm. And 10 to the 10 years is roughly speaking the age of the universe. And we don't have that much time to wait until our algorithm is finished. So this is usually referred to as the curse of dimensionality. The fact that as the size of the problem increases, and not too much actually, we are still below 100 items, the calculation time of the algorithm explodes and can take a lot of time. The NAPSAP problem is a very common problem in practice. For example, portfolio optimization in finance is a NAPSAP problem. So basically, in this case, the items are the potential assets that you can put in a portfolio. The utility are basically the return of each of these assets. And the weight can be the risk associated with the assets. So a portfolio optimization problem would consist in maximizing the return by putting a cap on the risk. So this is an NAPSAC problem. But in this context, the number of assets that are usually considered is way beyond 100. And you don't want to wait the age of the universe to solve your portfolio optimization problem. So in the context of combinatorial optimization, the set of feasible solutions is finite, but the number of feasible solutions is growing exponentially with the size of the problem, to a point where for relatively small sizes of the problem, a complete enumeration is not feasible. Moreover, these problems, combinatorial optimization problem, they don't have any optimality condition that we can exploit. So if you remember your analysis course from the bachelor, where the derivatives were used to characterize a minimum or a maximum, well, here we cannot do that. We have no continuity. It's just a set of combinations, right? Of combination of items. So there is no optimality condition that we can exploit. And this is why these problems are extremely difficult to solve. Let's consider another problem, which is very classical. It's called the traveling salesman problem. In this case, we have the following definition. So we have n cities that somebody needs to visit, a salesman. We know the distance that we denote by dij between any two cities. And the objective is to find an order in which the salesman must visit all the cities in such a way that the total distance is the smallest possible one. Okay, so here we have again a combinatorial optimization problem. So here, if you think about it, the number of possible solutions are the number of permutations of the n minus one cities that are not the home of the salesman. And how many are such permutations? Well, it's factorial n minus one. And actually, you can show that the factorial is basically something that grows exponentially with the size of the problem again. So this is a typical example of a combinatorial optimization problem, where brute force algorithm will work only with very small instances. Let's take a very simple example. I have four cities, Lausanne, Geneva, Zurich, and Bern. And I have identified the distance between each pair of two cities. So let's assume that the home is Lausanne. Okay. So the number of possibilities are all permutations of the remaining cities. We have three cities, so we have six possibilities to consider them. But the problem is symmetric, right? So going from Lausanne to Zurich to Geneva to Bern and back to Lausanne or the other way around is exactly the same. So among the six possibilities, we will only consider half of them, three. So here, I have enumerated these three possibilities. So Lausanne, Bern, Zurich, Geneva, Lausanne. Lausanne, Bern, Geneva, Zurich, Lausanne. And Lausanne, Zurich, Bern, Geneva, Lausanne. And then for each of them, I can calculate the length. And therefore, I can identify the optimal solution, which is here, Lausanne, Bern, Zurich, Geneva, Lausanne, with a total of 572 kilometers. Another family of interesting combinatorial optimization problems are integer linear optimization problems. So what we call linear optimization is an optimization problem where the objective function and the constraints are expressed as linear functions of the decision variables. So in this formulation, we have the objective function being the inner product between a cost vector and the decision variables. And the constraints are described as a set of linear equality constraints, with A being a matrix and B a vector, and non-negativity constraints on the decision variables. So this is called the linear optimization problem. Actually, it is written here in standard form. So what is an integer linear optimization problem? It's when we impose to all the variables x to be integer, everything else being the same. So somehow this can be seen as the intersection between the polyhedron characterizing the constraints of a linear optimization problem and the lattice of integer numbers. Let's have a look at what the feasible set looks like. So on the left you have the representation of a polyhedron, which is the geometrical object that characterizes the set of constraints of a linear optimization problem. On the right part, we have superposed on the polyhedron the lattice of all values that correspond to integer values of the decision variables. So these circles all correspond to the value of x2 equals 3, and x1 being 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in the context of integer linear optimization problem, we are interested in the intersection between this polyhedron and the integer lattice. So here, the set of feasible solution is this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, here, and here. So we have a total of 12 feasible solutions for this optimization problem. So this is the finite set of constraints of our combinatorial optimization problem in this context.